lecture today is about a very important question: why am I a Christian? Before being an evangelist, you should know how to answer this very important question, because you may face the question as is. Somebody will ask you why you are a Christian. If you are introduced the gospel anytime, you may face the question, the direct one, why you are a Christian. The first answer, I would say, I'm Christian because my God is to me the perfect God. I'm choosing the God I want to follow. So my God, according to my belief, is the perfect one. It's the perfect God I would love to follow. And by saying the perfect God, I would say how he is perfect. Also, we will state three main character in our God. He is the Almighty. He can do anything, and he is the very wise, good one, holy wisdom. He have had the whole wisdom we need, and also he is holy love. And by this triangle, by this three, I need nothing else. My God is very powerful, is very loving God, and very wise one. So I would never fear anything, because he loves me, and he can do anything for me, and he is wise enough to do the best for me. You understand? So first of all, I believe in God who can, I believe in God who love, I believe in God who is wise. So he is the perfect one. Many other gods are not loving gods. They consider them as almighty, but they are not loving. Other gods may be not wise, according to the beliefs of any of other religions or other cults. There are many gods, but we believe in one God, the perfect God, the Almighty, and the holy, love, and wise one. Also, my God, I'm now answering the first question: why am I Christian? My God is the perfect Father, is the ideal Father. My God is not just a holy God living in heaven out there. My God is very near to me. My God feels me. My God cares for me. My God is the best Father ever seen. And this is, you know, very specific to Christian faith, that God is our Father. The commonest prayer we pray, our Father who art in heaven. This is the commonest prayer, the usual prayer. So this is the cornerstone of our belief, that our God is a Father, and very good Father. And nobody need not a Father. Nobody on earth need not a Father. So we need him as a Father. The good one, perfect one, wise one, loving one. So we need a Father. He is ideal. And you know, the perfect story for explaining the fatherhood of our God is the story of the prodigal son and the daughter. Because you know, I believe that the master actor in this story is the father, not the son. The father accepted the son after a long period of sin, and he went to check for the second son when he refused to get in. So he's very kind and always welcoming to his sons, whatever they did before. And not only welcoming, but giving everything. So he's the ideal father. And in this Father, God, we can see the unconditioned love human beings need. We all as humans need the unconditioned love. We love each other, but conditionally, you know. I cannot bear you more than certain times, certain circumstances, but if you keep pushing me away, if you keep bothering me, if you keep insulting me, I don't think I can love you much more than this. But for God, He loves us in an unconditioned way, an unlimited way, without limits. He still loves us after many years of sinful life. So we need this. We preach the perfect God, the ideal Father. Also, our God, I'm reminding you, we are answering the main question, why you are Christian. I'm Christian because our God in Christianity is the only one who can repair or regain my image, my perfect image, which is inside me. You know, according to our belief, now we have like a distorted or corrupted picture of God. We are created on His image, but this image was corrupted by sin, by our will. And God is the only one who can restore this picture again. So my God can change me, can transform me back to His image. Nobody can make this for me. I need it badly. You know, we cry loud out of our hearts asking for this transformation. We cry needing this restored image again. So the only one can do this is God Himself. And God came to do this. So He is the master controller. I believe in my God as Dawood Lamei, Pantocrator. He is the master controller. So I live happily in this earth. I live peacefully because He is always there, fine-tuning everything around. He is controlling everything around. He knows the past. He knows the future. He is the master controller. So I would sleep peacefully. No other God can do this. Although He was up above there, but according to my belief, He is not up above. No, He is down with me in my problem. By incarnation, our God lived our life. Our God shared us our life. So I believe in God who is not out there. I'm believing in God who is living my life, sharing my pains and sufferings. He is not the humiliating God. In other cults and religions, God, you know, is a humiliating person. He enjoys insulting His people. He enjoys people worshipping Him. But we worship Him in a loving way. We worship Him because we love Him. He is not the proud God. No, we have seen our Lord Jesus Christ is very humble. So I believe in my perfect God as humble God. I like this God. I don't like other gods who are proud. Although He is almighty, but He is not the mighty one who put His hand on strongly on everything as if you are not living your will, your life willingly. You cannot enjoy your freedom if He is that mighty. But He is almighty, but He gives you all His power to enjoy your life. He even stay silent when you go outside His will. When you do whatever you like, He just keep silent and staying waiting for you to come back. Also, we answer the question, why you are Christian? I'm Christian because I'm proud of my God, because my God came to me, visited me, He lived on earth me. I can see my God. In other religions and cults, people cannot see their God. They believe in some power there, out there, but they cannot deal with it. They cannot relate much or communicate much. But my God came to me, lived on earth with me. So I believe in my God as the incarnated God. now we are reading the first chapter of St. John in his message, which was from the beginning, which we have heard, which we have seen with our eyes, which we have looked upon, and our hands have handled concerning the word of life. So we saw him, we listened to him, we touched him. Up to this moment we can say so. You know, in our masses we are saying, "Tuba la'yunkum la'ma tubsir." Bless your eyes because they see, bless your ears because they can hear. And we rather touch the body of Christ by our mouth when we eat the communion. So our relation to our God is not like a theoretical relation. He is not that higher God up there, but he is the incarnated God who can deal with me on earth. Also, this is the first point, by the way. In answering why you are Christian, the first answer, simply because I believe in the perfect God, the God who I need. I need a Father God, I need a kind God, I need an almighty God, I need the controller one for my sake, I need him to see him to share my life. The second answer, second point on my answer, that Christianity is the only way to make me the perfect man. I cannot be perfect without his perfection. I cannot go the road towards perfection without the power of my God. That's why our God became man, and he was the only perfect man. But he put the model in front of my eyes, so I can follow the model now. Now I know what perfection means. Before incarnation, I may not know what perfection for me as human being does mean. I do not know the meaning of perfection. But now I can see my Lord Jesus Christ as the perfect man, the only perfect man, who cared, who loved, who lived on earth, and he made everything without sin. So the perfection is not something ideal, theoretical, far away from human beings. After incarnation, I believe in Christ because he is also the perfect man. So simply I believe in my Lord Jesus Christ because he is the only perfect God, and also he is the only perfect man. And for the second point, I can follow him. So I can achieve my perfection through him. You know, many cults and religions are dealing with human beings as they are animals, or maybe like solid. Some believe that we are an outcome of some chemistry. You know, in many ideas, man is just an outcome of some chemical reactions. In other religions, we are just dust, merely dust. In other philosophy, we are just a complicated group of lusts. In others, desires take the man to his needs and to his goals. But in my belief, no, I'm the image of God. So Christianity give me the value, because I'm not an animal. I don't believe I'm part of this dust. I am not a group of lusts or desires. I'm the image of God. I like the idea. I feel my value in this. Yes, I am the image of God, although distorted, but I'm living to restore this image, this perfect image. You know, according to the philosophy, in the first century, they were saying, if dead do not rise, let's eat and drink, for tomorrow we die. This was the theme of the philosophy at that time. As far as we are going to die, let's eat and drink exactly like animals, because lastly we will die. And this, our Lord Jesus Christ, he kept saying, I am, And by saying I am, he means I am God and through me you can. I am the light of the world. Through me you can live in light, you can see. But without him you cannot, you can never see the truth, because there is no light. He is the light. So I believe in my Lord Jesus Christ because he is the light of this world. Also he said, I'm the way. There is no other way to heaven. There is no other way to happiness. There is no other way to peace outside my Lord Jesus Christ. So I believe in Christ as perfect God and perfect man, and the only one who can restore my happiness through the way, the perfect way. I'm the truth. Our Lord said so. He is the only truth. And by saying the truth, we can now accept this idea that he is the truth, meaning that he is the perfect God, the true God, and also he is the perfect man, the true man. No other God or man away from Jesus Christ. He is the perfect God and the perfect man, so he is the truth. If you seek the truth anywhere else, you are getting outside the way, outside the truth. Also he stated that I am the life. So there is no other life. You cannot live a real life outside the belief of Jesus Christ as God. Also our Lord said, I'm the resurrection and the life. By saying I'm the resurrection, that means that you can never enjoy the resurrection after unless you believe in him. You can enjoy the life after life by sticking to him, by living with him, by living by him. But there is no resurrection outside him. Also he said that I am, you know, this is a long lecture, but I won't say everything. He said that I am the good shepherd. I need somebody to guide me. I need somebody to care for me. I feel usually weak. So I need somebody to care, to love, to guide, to solve my problems. I need a shepherd. I need a kind one, the good shepherd. He is there. He is the good shepherd. So I need him. I'm Christian because my Lord Jesus Christ is the good shepherd. Is the light, is the life, is the truth, is everything. He is the perfect God. He is the perfect man. So I need him. Also he said, I'm the door. It's like on the way, because he is the door to every good thing, to the kingdom of heaven. Nobody can get into the kingdom of heaven without the belief in our Lord Jesus Christ. Also, so now we gave you two major points. In answering the major question of why you are Christian, I would say, I'm Christian because I believe in the perfect God, and I can explain why he is perfect. I believe in Christianity because I need the perfect man, and my Lord Jesus Christ is the only perfect man I can follow. The third point is, I believe in Christianity because this is the perfect life. By believing in God, in our Lord Jesus Christ as God, we can enjoy the perfect life. There are many models of life you can live, but no life on earth is a real, ideal, good life away from Christ life. So our Lord Jesus Christ is not only the model, but he lives in me to give me the beauty of life, to help me to live my life happily. So it was written in Psalm 44, for the man who desires life and loves many days. You know, this is an entrance or a way approach. You can approach many non-believers by this idea, that if you like to live your full life, to get the utmost of your life, who is the man who desires life and loves many days, that he may see good, keep your tongue from evil and your lips from speaking deceit, depart from evil and do good, seek peace and pursue it. By doing the first few advices, it's just morals. But the last one, when he says, seek peace, he is the only peace. So go take him. That's why our Lord Jesus Christ in John chapter 10 said, I have come that they may have life and that they may have it more abundantly. You will get your life more abundantly. So we are preaching a better life. We are preaching the abundant life. People are living lives, but their lives are very cheap. We can make it more rich by believing and living in God. Also, it's written in John 17, this is eternal life, that they may know you, the only true God, and Jesus Christ whom you have sent. This is the eternal life. You started the eternal life from now. By believing in him as God, by following him, you can start your eternal life from now. Also, it's written in Romans 14, for the kingdom of God is not eating and drinking. You know, our Lord is preaching the rich life of eating and drinking. This is what they can give. They don't have much more than this. A life full of eating and drinking, but our life, eternal life, kingdom of heaven, is much more than this. Our kingdom of God is not eating and drinking, but righteousness and peace and joy in the Holy Spirit. So this is the perfect life. First answer was the perfect God, the second perfect man, and the third perfect model of life. Also written in John chapter 1, in him was life, and the life was the light of men. So in him was life, that means no real life outside him. Also written, as he sent me into the world, I also have sent them into the world. It means that you can never enjoy a real life in God unless you have a mission to do. When you feel like God sent you to the people, you will get everything out of your life. When you lose your mission, you lose your messenger mission, now you are nothing. You are just a human being living and waiting for his time to die. The last point in this, we are having the perfect book. You know, in many religions, they consider the book of that religion. I remember when I was in the airport of Abu Dhabi, a woman, Muslim woman, looking at me in this way, and she asked me politely, you are Christian? Yes, I'm Christian. Do you have a book? I said, yes, we have a book. Oh, thank God. That's very good. She said so. Why it's very good? Because she believes, as far as you are the people of the book, you know, and look at that. So this is good. You have a reference, you know. You have your reference from God. This is her belief, which is great. But I believe concerning this time that we have not only a book, the perfect book. Because there are many books, but we have the perfect book. As we believe in the perfect God and perfect man model and perfect life we can live, also we have the perfect book, the perfect reference. You know, our book was written by 40 writers in 1,600 years, and this is the longest book ever written, and the most consistent one, and very much solid and strong. You know, the Word of God said on the Word of God, the Word of God explained the Word of God by being a hammer, a sword, a fire, a food, a treasure, a light, seeds, trump. These all like examples of the power of the Word of God. This is our book. He is like the light in this world. He is like the sword. It's like the sword. You can conquer every evil thing by the word of God. It's like the fire, which can fire everything. Fire in a good way. Fire love in every heart. So this is the examples of the word of God inside the word of God. Also, the word of God can educate me, can guide me, can give me condolence, can enrich me, can enlighten me, can purify me. And also the word of God is the major factor in my growth. So the word of God does everything. I cannot live without the word of God. So I'm Christian simply because I have the perfect book. The book who can give me everything. Light, happiness, guidance, richness, everything. Okay? Now let's shift to the next question. I'm sorry to tell you there is another question. Why am I Orthodox? This is another question. Because this is a bit different. We know now we can answer the question, why you are Christian, by saying, I believe in the perfect God, perfect man, or perfect humanity, in our Lord Jesus Christ, perfect life I can live, and perfect book. Now we know the answer, I think. How about saying why you are specifically Orthodox? Why you are not just Christian? This is a good question. Remember yesterday when we were talking to Father Mikhail of Namibia, he said that most of the people living around him, they are Christians but not Christians. They do not know much about Christ, they do not read the Bible usually, but they are Christians. Now we are preaching the Orthodox faith. What is the difference in this? Why am I an Orthodox? First of all, we would love to define Orthodox. You know, dox is related to major Greek words, dogma, doxology. Doxology, sometimes they say that it means related to dogma. Dogma is a aqidah, and actually it's much related to the doxata tree. Doxa, a little magd, glory. You understand? So by the phrase dox means praising. Okay? Also is the straight line. Also is the proper good straight line. So by saying orthodox, we means that we believe in a straight way and we praise God in the perfect straight way. Maybe there are other ways, but this is, you know, the straightest way. So you can put it like the rightful way to praise God, rightfulness, straightness, in belief and praising, and they are very much related. When you believe rightly, you will praise God rightly. So I'm revising now. You are Christian because by Christianity you will know the real perfect God, and also by Christianity you will know the truth, the human being truth through Jesus Christ. Also you will know your mission on earth, and lastly you will know your eternal life waiting for you. This is Christianity simply. You know God and you know how to live your life through Jesus Christ, and you are waiting for the eternal life, and all through your life you have a mission. Simply, this is the answer of why Christian. Now why Orthodox? The first point, because the Orthodox faith is the purest belief. Millions of people believe in our Lord Jesus Christ, but let me put it this way, they are not very pure in their belief, because some other ideas came through the history and introduced themselves into the beliefs of Christians, and they were not perfect, they were not right, they were not traditional, they were not given by the apostles and by our Lord Jesus Christ. So it's, there is some shayaib, impurities in many other beliefs. But you know, the Orthodox, is the purest one, still the purest one. We are not saying the Orthodox are the best one, no, please. No, we are saying just that the Orthodox faith is still the purest faith, which stand against all the impurities coming all through the 2000 years happened. It was written in Judah, but you beloved, building yourselves up on your most holy faith. This is the most holy faith. Building yourselves up on yourself are built up on the holy faith, praying in the Holy Spirit. Also it was written in the Sermon of the Mountain, according to the words of our Lord Jesus Christ, beware of false prophets who come to you in sheep's clothing, but inwardly they are ravenous wolves. So our Lord said so. Concerning the purest belief, I wish to give you again the famous story of Aquila and Priscilla. It was written in Acts that a certain Jew named Apollos, born at Alexandria, an eloquent man and mighty in the scriptures. He was very good in the scriptures. He is a real Christian, a good one. Came to Ephesus. This man had been instructed in the way of the Lord, and being fervent in the spirit, he spoke and taught accurately the things of the Lord, though he knew only the baptism of John. So he began to speak boldly in the synagogue. When Aquila and Priscilla heard him, they took him aside and explained him the way of God more accurately. I would say on my Orthodox faith this sentence. I'm just saying that I think my Orthodox faith is the way of God more accurately. Simply. So I would love to give this accurate faith to all who like to evangelize or to preach anywhere. And actually, Apollos, as we know, were very humble, accepted this teaching, and he was very good after, and the church accepted his teaching, and he preached Christ and church, he preached Christ and sacraments, and he preached in the Orthodox way. Because he accepted this kind of modeling or remodeling his way. That was written after, when he desired to cross the issue, the brethren wrote exhorting the disciple to receive him, and when he arrived, he greatly helped those who had believed. So he shared very good share after, because he believed the accurate way. Also, if you go through the history, if you study the Coptic or the Orthodox history, you will see that our church faced many heresies all through the history, starting from Judaism. Judaism is the first heresy faced the first church, and St. Paul and other disciples feared the heresy, and they made their synagogue in Jerusalem, and they came out with many advices to the church to stop this teaching of Judaism. After, they got some heresy called Gnosis. Gnosis is a philosophical idea that by the mind, by thinking, by thoughts, by just the knowledge, you can know God away from physical worship, away from any deeds. Just, it's a matter of thinking. So like Christianity is a philosophy. So Gnosis was a heresy. Our church feared the heresy. After it came the Nicolaism, and Arius, Macedonius, Nestor, many heresies came attacking the pillars of our Christian faith. either attacking the doctrine of Trinity or the doctrine of incarnation or the doctrine of the Holy Spirit as being God, or the doctrine of the Church or the one baptism. All through the history we faced many heresies, and the Church fixed their belief on what they received from our Lord Jesus Christ through the disciples. The second point, we are Orthodox, believe in the purest belief or the purest faith. Also we had the most trustful book, and this is a major problem now, because other denominations have the same book, the Bible. But actually we mean by saying the most trustful book that we understand our book, the Bible, as exactly what the disciples meant when they wrote the words. You know, I may say something, but you accept it in different way from what I meant. Understand? So you should ask me again, did you mean so and so? We believe the Holy Spirit, who wrote the book through the disciples, gave our forefathers, the fathers of the Church in the first few centuries, the blessing of understanding the words of the Bible as was exactly meant by. So we are following the explanations and the sermons of our forefathers in the first few centuries, those who followed the disciples, who explained every single sentence in the Bible. Now we know what exactly they meant by saying so and so. Nowadays, any preacher may come and say a sentence from the Bible, but he preached the sentence in his own way. Maybe he is deviated from the exact right way the disciples meant or the Holy Spirit meant, because it shouldn't be many explanations for the same sentence or different antagonists. It couldn't be that like this. Either the Holy Spirit meant that the body of Christ is real, or he meant the body of Christ is fake. What did he mean by saying the body of Christ? Do I eat the body of Christ as real body of Christ? I know it's not the flesh, but how my Lord said, this is my body. Should I accept it faithfully that this is the body of Christ? And I would say amen, because I'm not eating flesh, so I should believe. Or I would think it in another way, it's just an idea, but this is not real. Different ideas. So the Holy Spirit either meant it this way or this way. You understand? So I should ask my forefathers, how did you accept this sentence? Did you live the 400 years before any denominations come, believing that you are eating real body of Christ? Yes. Did you have an altar in your church? Yes. Did you have priests? Yes. Did you have deacons? Yes. Did you have intercession of Saint Mary, angels, apostles? Yes. Did you have martyrdom? Yes. Did you have like the idea of monasteries and monks? Yes. So now I'm following the steps of the previous saints. Now we believe in Saint George and who? And Saint Athanasius, Saint Antonius, and these people followed the steps of their four apostles before. So we are following them. So I cannot understand the Bible in my way. This would not be the trustful book, you understand? So we mean by the Orthodox way that we understand the book as it was meant by. How do we understand the Holy Book? You know, in Timothy, the second letter, it was written by St. Paul, the things that you have heard from me among many witnesses, commit these to faithful men who will be able to teach others also. Look how he is passionate, eager, and caring to to deliver the message properly to his son and after to the people after him. Also written, therefore, brethren, stand fast and hold the traditions which you were taught, whether by word or our epistle. So you keep the traditions. You are not allowed to change what you had received. Just teach what you received before, generation after generation. Also it's written, if anyone teaches otherwise and does not consent to wholesome words, even the words of our Lord Jesus Christ, and to the doctrine which accords with godliness, he is proud, knowing nothing, but is obsessed with disputes and arguments over words from which come envy, strife, reviling, evil, suspicions, useless wranglings of men of corrupt mind and destitute of the truth, who support that godliness is a means of gain. From such withdraw yourself. So it was written in the book, there are many other teachings which you shouldn't follow. So we are preaching the Orthodox faith, not because we believe that we are the best. No, not this idea. But actually we believe this is the trustful book, and this is the meaning of the book as we received it. This is the tradition we lived 2000 years. We cannot ignore it. So, you know, the Bible in the Orthodox Church is related very much to the saints' biographies, to the traditions, to the liturgy, and to the writings of the forefathers. Remember this idea. We cannot understand the Bible away from the traditions. The order of the Church explain the Bible. The saints' life explain our Bible. The liturgy, the word of the liturgy, explain the Bible, and the writings of the Father explain the Bible. Through these we can actually accept the right meaning of the words written in the Bible. That's why Saint Augustine said that I cannot understand the Bible out of the Church. Many people now try to understand the Bible away from the Church, so they will get another book. And this is written in Galatians, by the way, that Saint Paul said there might be another book. He meant that you may accept your book in another way, not what the Holy Spirit meant by. Also, the Orthodox, so we said, the first point, I believe in Orthodox Christianity because this is the purest faith. The second point, this is the trustful book, or the honest meaning of the book. The third point is the most sacred life. What do we mean by this? You know, in the Orthodox life, I mean pattern of worshipping God. When you study the life of our saints, you can see a standard of sacredness, of living with God, higher than many other denominations. Again, I'm not saying we are only the best. No, don't accept this way. But look to the history and just ask yourself why there are not such saints in all other churches, I mean away from the Orthodox, and the Catholic are very near to us in name. So concerning the sacred life, we have a very nice meaning in our Orthodox belief called synergism. Synergism is a word born by the tongue of the forefathers, means that there are always synergy, means sharing the part, the role of God and the role of man. And it's like a symphony, the symphony between the God's part and man's part. You cannot ignore any of them. You cannot go to heaven by yourself, and God cannot take you without your will and your part. So that's what we call grace and struggle. We need grace, but we need to struggle. Also, there is faith and deeds. And there is no real faith without deeds. Also, there is hope and fear. I hope to go to heaven, but I fear losing heaven. So this is, you know, the synergism. I believe in the Bible, and on the same level I believe in the sacraments of the church. I cannot live without any of them. Also, I believe in repentance and discipleship. It means that I do not repent once. I would repent or change for my whole life. Transformation is a dynamic story related to discipleship. The last question in 5 minutes. So we studied why am I Christian and why I'm Orthodox. The last idea would be why am I Coptic. This is not related to preaching much. You know, we are not preaching the Coptic culture. As you heard from Amba Angelus, Amba Bachonius, Amba Antonius, they were very frank in this. We are not preaching the Coptic culture. And this, I would say, one of the problems in our church, in America, Australia, and Canada, sometimes we preach not the Bible, not the Orthodox faith, but the Coptic culture. As if those who cannot eat a full betana, they cannot go to the kingdom of heaven. This is a real problem. No, we are preaching our Orthodox beliefs, but we are not preaching our Coptic traditions, Coptic culture, I mean. This is not something sacred. Let's put the idea now. Why am I Coptic? In few minutes. I read part from Acts 22nd, Philip, and as they bound him with thongs, Paul said unto the centurion that stood by, is it lawful for you to scourge a man that is a Roman and uncondemned? When the centurion heard that, he went and told the chief captain, saying, take heed what thou dost, for this man is a Roman. Then the chief captain came and said unto him, tell me, art thou a Roman? He said, yes. And the chief captain answered, with a great sum obtained I this freedom. And Paul said, but I was freeborn. Then straightway they departed from him which should have examined him, and the chief captain also was afraid, after he knew that he was a Roman, and because he had bound him. I feel so much. This meaning, St. Paul said, I was born in disgrace, I did not pay any penny. Many will buy being Coptic. Many, if they understand the story, will buy being Coptic. And you will say now, see now, but you should be proud as being Coptic. This is not related to your salvation much, but I would tell you why you are proud of being Coptic. Not only Christian, not only Orthodox, but you're also proud of being Coptic. The first idea, that the most glorious Christian history ever in the history is the Coptic history. Why? We had in our land, in Alexandria, the first and the largest theological school in Alexandria. And from this school, all the popes, the patriarchs, the bishops of the few first centuries, not only for our church, for the European and other churches, came out of this school. It is, we are telling now, Saint Basile liturgy. Saint Basile is not Coptic, but Saint Basile studied in this school. Saint Gregory is not Coptic, he's not Egyptian. You know, Coptic, by the way, is Egyptian, okay? He's not Egyptian, but he came studying in our school. This school was the school of Saint Athanasius, Saint Clement, and the precious teachers of theology up to this moment in all Christian denominations. Also, we had the protectors of faith. Up to this moment, all Christians all over the world, they are, you know, greeting Saint Athanasius, Saint Cyril, because they kept the faith pure. If they study the history, our Christian faith was about to deviate in many other ways. But because of our forefather, the Egyptian, Sa'ad ibn, they were great and they kept the faith proper for everybody all over the world. Also concerning the history, we started the idea of monastic life. The forefathers, Saint Anthony, Saint Macarius, Saint Bachonius, are the four fathers of monasticism all over the world. Al-Rahbana, Tadit from Masr, Muntasharat Masr. Also, according to the history, the good accurate history, the Egyptian martyrs are more than any martyrs in number all over the history. We have days on our land that 100,000 of martyrs on one day for Christ. So we gave our Lord Jesus Christ millions of our people, millions. So it's a big number for their Christian faith, because we did not have like one stage of persecution. We up to this moment lived persecuted from the Roman area to the problem of heresies area. They were Christian against Christians, and we always were the persecuted part. And after the entrance of Arabs, so we kept our Christian life persecuted. We gave God millions of our fathers. I can't say any of you should have in his biography, in his history, what they call the tree of the family tree. He would trace a martyr in his family. He cannot sit this way. He cannot born Christian unless he had one of his grandfathers killed for the name of Christ. The second point concerning the Coptic Orthodox faith, that we have the most beautiful prayers order. Saddaqouni bidun ta'assub, inshallah bil English. I'll tell you why. Let's focus on the Al-Jum'a Kabir, Good Friday. On this day, look upon the church. They go to the church like 5 o'clock in the early morning, and they stay in the church up to 6 at least afternoon. And most of the people are waiting this day. I never saw a church in the whole world can let her people pray 12 hours and they are not there. They are waiting this day. This is because of the order, Pax. Because they put the prayers in nice, very changeable way from an hour to the other, to follow the steps of our Lord Jesus Christ. We are focusing the 12 hours on the cross. Wow, this is great. This is really an art. It's not easy. You cannot pray yourself by your words more than half an hour. How about 12 hours and thousands everywhere in the churches are waiting this day because of the church. You know, many of them just go to have some lunch and a few hours rest and come back to the church to spend the whole night, another 8 hours. Abu Ghalan sees. A few hours rest and then come back to the liturgy of the feast. What these people do? How can they take this? How can they spend in 2 days like 20 hours praying? And they are waiting for this. And before that, a whole week, many of our congregation spend day and night in the church because of the order of the church. So we have really the best system of praying, what we call taqs, order of prayer. We are not preaching that only Copts will go to heaven. No, we preach the Orthodox faith. but we are proud of being Copts because we enjoy our Lord our way. You understand? When we go to any country, we will not push all our orders and all our Coptic language and all our Coptic songs in their culture. No, not necessarily. But we are delivering the Orthodox Christian faith. And we are proud of being Coptic. We may introduce some of our Coptic Coptic touch. They may like it or they may not. But we enjoy our worship this way. Also, more al-Aqdiya, concerning the daily praying, we are the only church in the whole world that for the congregation, not for the monks, they are trying to pray 7 times daily. They are trying to do so, maybe 3 minutes on each hour. But this is, you know, the standard of praying before us. So this is great. And we are relating each hour with the life of our Lord Jesus Christ, with the Bakr, with the morning prayer. We are relating ourselves to the resurrection. With the third hour, we are relating to the gift of the Holy Spirit. With the sixth hour, we are focusing on the cross. With the ninth hour, we are focusing on the death of our Lord. On the sunset and twelfth hour, we are meditating on the end of our life. So we are enjoying the full day with our Lord. This is the Coptic pattern of worshipping God. We are not saying this is the only pattern we can worship through, but this is a good one. I believe the best. Also, you know, concerning the, on the weekly basis, you can enjoy the Sunday feast. We have a feast each Sunday. Also, on the monthly basis, we are having a feast on the 29th, on the 21st, on the 12th, one for the Saint Michael, Malek Michael, and one for Saint Mary, and the 29th for the birth of our Lord Jesus Christ and resurrection of our Lord. So we are even having feasts all over the year, and specifically on the Sundays. We are the only church which have 14 Ayat Sayyidina, which means feasts for our Lord, 14. Many church just in the level Yama. Other church they put a little where, but we have 14 big feasts for our Lord best. Away from the feasts of the Saint Mary and Martyrs and you know, I don't have time to talk about the fasting, all the fasting, although we do not like to fast much. But actually, the fasting is the narrow way to the heaven. So our church is pushing us through this narrow way, because when we fast, we are tightening ourselves. So it pushes us in this way by changing the meaning of the fast each time. This fast, we are waiting Christ coming from heaven, so we are happy. We are praying in Kirk, praising God. In the Lent, Islamic Kabir, we are repenting because we are facing the cross and the sufferings of our Lord Jesus Christ. In Saint Mary fasting, we are looking at the best model ever of our generation. So we have many meanings. We fast with these meanings to push us up to heaven. The liturgy, I don't have time for this. Okay, the third point, the last one, we have the greatest land. The only land visited by our Lord Jesus Christ, away from his land, is Egypt. He chose to come to our land. He visited our land. He stayed in Egypt 3.5 years. He walked on our earth. And he walked on earth, on our earth, Bahari Ibli. Yes, they spent most of the time walking with Saint Mary because they were running out of the Romans, you know. So it's great that all the steps of our Lord, he went on our earth more than he walked in Jerusalem and Judea and Samaria, because our land is bigger. So if you follow the map of Egypt, you can see how much our Lord Jesus Christ walked in our map. And for all his steps, there were after monasteries and churches and martyrs. So our land is really great. I knew that some of the tourists coming from a European country, and they were studying the Coptic history. They saw them after they getting out of the bus in Akhmin. They all knelt down and they kissed the land. They are foreigners, and when they asked them, "Why did you do so? This is just dust," they said, "In this area, the blood of the martyrs were up to this. We knew from the books, your land is great. No land like this land. So you should be proud being Egyptian, being Coptic." And our land, Abraham, Ishaq, Yaqub, Moses was born in our land. Armea was killed in our land. Many visited our land. I'm sorry, none of the world. Now you know I'm Christian, I'm Orthodox, I'm Coptic. Glory to God, amen. The homework, the first question, you can write down, please, how evangelism is very much related to the liturgy or the Eucharist. So the question is from the Hulagi, the book of prayer, the liturgy book. Please revise the liturgy of Saint Basil. You know we have three masses, Saint Basil and Gregory and Cyril. We need the first one, the classic, the usual Saint Basil liturgy, and we will go through the whole prayer to pick up the ideas related to evangelism. As I show some of them yesterday, like we pray for the poor, for the widows, for the strangers, we pray for the non-believers, we pray for those who are still outside the church, we pray for everything. And you can see many ideas related to evangelism. So just try to go through the Hulagi to pick out the ideas related to evangelism. The second question from chapter 2 in the first message to Thessaloniki الأولى إصحاح 2. Thessaloniki الأولى إصحاح 2. Please pick out the good characteristics of Saint Paul and all the people of Thessaloniki. Because he was saying in this letter that their service was perfect and their acceptance was also perfect. They introduced the gospel in a very good way, and they accepted the message in a very good way. So we are trying to pick out the ideas related to the good missionary and those who accept or receive the message, how they could be very good, which resulted in a successful mission or evangelism. Both the characteristics of the missionary himself, Saint Paul and his group, and those accepted the message. Okay? There are many points, like more than 10 points you can pick up related even to Saint Paul first.